to me, one of the problems with that, you know, I've been talking about actually in the press is that, and I'm not an expert on this, but one of the problems just seems to be that the studios haven't got ahead of the internet, and they haven't really figured out a way to make the internet work for the industry, really. It's
well, they're still kind of stuck in the old days.
Well, yeah.
And it's very, you know, newspapers have had a very hard time.
It's leading to bad movies, and it's ultimately creating a bad film industry right now, a very, very dull film industry.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right. Well,
but then we get surprises now and again.
Right, yes, yeah.
To remind us there's a reason to live.
Yeah, I guess
which I think District 9 was for a lot of people this summer.
Yeah, that was fun. That was a real surprise. A total surprise for everybody, for all of us.
So what was your first thing as a kid? What was the impetus to get you to make the very early movies and even to think about the idea of making movies at the beginning?
Well, I sort of combine two loves, really, I guess, which is a love of model making. And just, you know, as a kid, I used to make plastic kit sets, and I eventually moved on to doing plasticine dinosaurs and sort of little rubber creatures and things. And that combined with being, you know, fueled by early television, because New Zealand in the 1960s had just one channel, black and white. But I completely, you know, became obsessed with stuff like Thunderbirds, the Gerry Anderson show, and the Avengers. I remember the Diana Rigg episodes of the Avengers, and Batman was around at that time. And then my parents got a Super 8 movie camera, and I would have been, I guess, about 7 or 8 years old. And so everything sort of naturally came together. I was interested in these movies and TV shows, mainly TV shows, because I never really went to movies much when I was young. I remember a couple of early films, but I was always mainly TV. And I realized that with a camera I could film my models, and I could create little scenarios a bit like Thunderbirds. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I used to get the plastic Thunderbirds models was one of the sort of very early merchandising that used to happen in the 60s, was with the Thunderbirds, the ITC Lou grade. Figured out how to do it and sell these models to kids. And then I would create these adventures and film them. And it slowly grew from there. And then seeing King Kong, the original King Kong, happened very soon after that when I was about probably 9 years old. And that did it for me. That was the film that really made me want to become a filmmaker, because it was so magical and such an escapist trip that I wanted to be the guy that actually sort of could do that and make these things happen and start from nothing, but, you know, create adventures that, that had all this stuff on them.
Was there a reason to think it was possible that, you know, you're New Zealand, you're a 10-year-old?
Well, it was possible because I had a camera and I could make models, so that was possible. I had no concept of what the professional film industry was like. That it really wasn't what I was thinking. I was just living day by day, and you know, and I had my cameras and I was filming things. I mean, I've actually just recently started to restore some of my old Super 8 films, because they've been sitting in drawers unseen for a long time, and now that I'm you know, I'm lucky enough to own a very state-of-the-art post-production facility, I've got the guys there in their downtime when they're not working on other films to be restoring my old Super 8 movies, because I want to show my kids. I've got movies starring me, because they always used to star me, you see, the films.
That's why I make a movie if it doesn't star you.
Absolutely. And I'm starring in these movies, you know, when I'm 8 or 9, and I've got 13, 14-year-old kids who are older than I am when I'm in these movies, and they haven't seen them. And so I want to show my kids me. I mean, I'm going to get no end of teasing about it, but the first one is a World War II movie with me in a trench. And some other friends. It's not just me. I had some extras as well, and toy guns, and we're shooting and stuff. And then
inspired by anything in particular, or just your imagination at that
point? Imagination. That was all just imagination.
It wasn't a Kubrick homage.
No. Although at some point I saw The Longest Day, you know, on TV, and I rushed out and restaged the landing on Normandy with about 6 or 7 of my friends, because we lived on the coast, so I had the beach there. And fortunately, in the 60s, all of my family, many uncles and friends in the street that we lived in, they all came, they all had World War II experience. And mm-hmm. so I got them to dig into their attics, and I got lots of tin helmets and uniforms and packs, and occasionally a valuable souvenir German helmet would come out, which was really cool. So I was able to get together a little costume collection, which was useful.
And then you moved along through high school into... Your productions get bigger?
Well, I tried to remake King Kong, and I shot a little bit of that, and I still have the puppets. I still have...
In Super 8?
I'm in Super 8, and I had the, I've got a cardboard top of the Empire State Building sort of summit, which I've still got that as well, and I've got this very decomposing rubber King Kong. I've got a Tyrannosaurus Rex and a Triceratops who were supposed to be having battles, and I filmed a little bit of that, filmed a bit of a Brontosaurus, and then I saw another big influence was the movie Waterloo, which was 1970, so I would have been 9 years old or 10 years old. And so I had, by that stage, I'd already had big armies of Waterloo soldiers, plastic soldiers, which I'd painted up. So then I did a big Waterloo battle with my plastic soldiers, sort of stop motion animation. So they're all just marching along, and cotton wool explosions and cannon, batteries of cannons firing and explosions and soldiers being blown up. World War One, the Blue Max with George Pappard was another big influence, and I had plastic model planes and I set fire to those. They burn really well. Those old Revell and Airfix kits, if you set fire to them, big black smoke and nice orange flames. Probably incredibly toxic, but it doesn't matter. And I was kind of filming them, holding them just off camera with my fingers as they were burning down to, and filming them as against the clouds. So I'd get all these shots of the real clouds and the planes going out of control. And I just got boxes and boxes of these things. And then I got the first thing that really happened in my teenage years was the started to make a Hammer horror movie, because that was the next. See, I was getting older. I was beginning to get sort of sophisticated tastes now. and Hammer horror was big. I remember loving a double feature that we had in this local cinema of Captain Kronos Vampire Hunter with Frankenstein and the Monster from Hell, which was terrific, really great. Peter Cushing kind of saws this guy's skull off and lifts his brain off. I remember that image was just great. And anyway, Captain Kronos Vampire Hunter, which is a very obscure Hammer film, which I really loved, and so I started doing a kind of a remake of that, where I play this 18th century swashbuckling vampire hunter guy, and we had a local cemetery that was really gothic with overgrown graves and cracked tombstones and all that. So I used to get friends of mine, do them up as zombies, and I'd be there with this sort of Napoleonic uniform with a crossbow with firing wooden stakes, and I used to go to the cemetery and we used to do all this zombie battling in the middle of the cemetery, which was a lot of fun. And I filmed most of that. I'm transferring all of that movie to video at the to HD at the moment, to Blu-ray, because I didn't edit a lot of it and I shot most of it. So I'm actually going to see if I can put most of it together now, because I did film most of this feature film. I don't think it's worthy of a major release, but because I was about 13 years old, but I have got most of a feature film shot in Super 8.
Well, you could give it the Forgotten Silver treatment.
I could, yeah, I could. I could build some other narrative around this footage.
So that sounds like you're getting closer to the feelies.
Yeah, I am
getting... A little more genre.
I am getting closer and closer, and then... But a big breakthrough was learning to edit movies too, learning to actually splice them together. And this was still Super 8 that I chopped up. And
the sound is brutal in Super 8 to try to edit that.
Well, I never had sound much on my Super 8 films. Sound was always one of those complicated, expensive things that in New Zealand we couldn't get the equipment. And you used to have to send Super 8 away to have a sound stripe glued on the side of it, which was very difficult, and then it would start peeling away. But I do have some sound on the Vampire Hunter film has a bit of sound. And then I shot a James Bond film with me playing James Bond. course, naturally.
Tuxedo?
Tuxedo.
Fake tuxedo or a real tuxedo?
A real tuxedo. I grabbed Dad's tuxedo. He had a tuxedo. And at this point, I'm about 15 years old. And I always loved the Sean Connery version where he had that hat he was wearing, that, you know, in Dr. No, he's wearing that kind of trilby hat or whatever it is. So Dad had one of those too. So I'm the Sean Connery version with a hat on. And I'm impersonating his accent because we did shoot that in sound. And I'm saying, hello, I'm James Bond. I'm sort of, you know, doing this sort of thing. And I do these fight scenes with a couple of my friends. And they were really, you know, quite well choreographed fights, but it was all to do with editing. And that was where I learned how to chop this film up with scissors and glue it back together again with little bits of paste and glue. And that was a big breakthrough, actually, learning to edit movies. And then when I was... the first sort of commercial thing I did was in school when I was about... it was actually just before the Bond film. I was about 13. And I made a, me and some friends at school made a Monty Python ripoff called Ponty Mython's Flying Circus, which was basically us recreating all of our favourite Monty Python sketches, because that was on TV at the time. This was in 1973 or something, and it was just at the height of Monty Python's Flying Circus.
They kind of made that movie too.
Well, they did, and now for something completely different. Yeah. And that was sort of our version of a now for something completely different, including the funniest joke in the world, where the guy laughs dying and they use it as a weapon. That was one of our sketches. And we had Gumbies, and we had the idiot race where the Olympics for half-wits, where they try to leap over little rows of boxes and stuff. And so we ripped off our favourite Python sketches, and that movie ended up being 10 minutes long, and I remember it cost $12 to make, which was the cost of the Super 8 film. And we charged the kids at school to see it. We ran it during the lunch hour, and we charged 10 cents. And when I added up all the 10 cent pieces, it came to exactly $12.
Wow.
We got our money back perfectly.
Was your family supportive of this through the whole?
Yeah,
process?
Well, I was only child, so, you know, which in some respects was helpful, I guess, because it meant that Mum and Dad, you know, they were really supportive of what I wanted to do. They were totally supportive. I mean, they didn't understand it, and they had no background really in any of this. My mother was a sort of amateur actor. She used to, when she was in England, because they came from England, she used to be in church, sort of village dramas, you know, when they would run a little Agatha Christie play in the church hall or something. She used to act in those. So she had this theatrical kind of quality that she liked, but no filmmaking background or anything.
So family does seem to be a big part of a lot of your pictures, sometimes for better, sometimes for worse. But
yeah.
I mean, even the Rings movies, really, it's about a family
in
some ways. But, you know, certainly Lovely Bones, certainly Heavenly Creatures. There's that strong sense of family tie.
I guess so. I don't know. It's hard for me to relate that back to my family. I mean, I just had a lovely childhood. I don't look back on it with anything other than absolute rose-tinted glasses. You know, for the right reasons. I had great support of parents. I lived in a little town called Pukerua Bay, which was an adventurous place to live. It was, our house was on the edge of a cliff, literally a cliff down to the ocean. And there was hills and forests to explore and streams and to film. And I mean, it was a great childhood,
So you extended that adventure of New Zealand as a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you probably shot New Zealand more than anybody else, I guess.
Shot some bits of it, yeah. One of the beauties of Lord of the Rings, actually, was that I got to explore New Zealand. I mean, I there was a lot of places I hadn't been at, but the location hunting for Lord of the Rings gave me a helicopter tour of the entire country that lasted for 2 or 3 weeks, and I was very grateful for that.
So there are parts of it that you still want to film that you haven't put a camera in?
Oh yeah, well, you'll see quite a bit of new New Zealand in The Hobbit. We've just been recently doing some location scouting for The Hobbit, and we found a whole lot of new places. There's new hills and mountains and waterfalls that have never been seen before that will be appearing in The Hobbit.
So the evolution of you from, was there a point where you became, besides your $12 score, which obviously very good,
is
there a moment where you said, okay, commercial filmmaker, it's time to become a professional?
Well, the trouble with New Zealand is that we never had a feature film industry particularly, not when I was growing up. And I wanted to leave school. I mean, what filmmaking to me was really about having to do it yourself. Like, literally, it was all about believing in yourself. You couldn't look towards a career and becoming a trainee or an apprentice or being a clapper loader or anything. That didn't, those jobs didn't exist because there was no industry. So I grew up really feeling that I was going to have to do it myself if I wanted to do it. And so therefore it became all about the equipment and it became about the technology. And I was, you know, shooting on Super 8, and I left and I wanted to leave school as fast as I could, because on one hand my parents did hope for me to go to university, and they did want me to become, they felt that I would end up in a career, like, I know that they wanted me to be an architect, because I was quite good at drawing, and I think they thought that an architectural career would be a safe career, and they sort of were trying to prompt me into that. But I just wanted to get out of school as fast as I could and get a job, because then I could afford to get 16 millimeter gear, because I couldn't afford to buy it other unless I actually got to work and earn money. So I left school when I was 16, didn't go to university, and I did it deliberately just so I could start getting some money. But I did the only job interview I did when I left school was to try to get a job in a laboratory in our post-production facility in New Zealand, which is called the National Film Unit. And it used to process government films. They used to make travel logs and sort of documentaries and, films for the government, as it were, sheep shearing films, and how to raise, corn and trainee films for farmers and all that sort of stuff. So they had a laboratory that processed film, and there was no vacancy. It wasn't a job that was available, but I got an interview with them to see if they'd take me on when I left school, and they turned me down. And that night, my mother was looking in the newspaper at the jobs, because I'd left school at this stage. I had nowhere else to go, and I'd just been turned down at the one film job that existed in the whole country. And she saw an advertisement for a photolithographer apprentice, and I didn't know what that was, but it had the word photo in it. And I went for that interview, which I got that interview, and I ended up being an apprentice for 3 years, having to go through all the apprenticeship, and then I was there for another 4 years. So I basically worked at a newspaper as a photo engraver, which is all to do with the reproducing the halftones in the newspaper. In those days, we sort of etched them with nitric acid, very dangerous, no safety equipment, and all fumes of all this acid fumes and stuff.
And you're all this whole time thinking about what's next?
Now I'm earning $75 a week, which is pretty good. It was amazing at the time. And $75 a week is now, and my parents didn't charge me board. I other friends of mine were leaving home and getting flats and all that, but to me that just cost money, and I wanted to buy cameras. So I stayed at home with my parents, who'd never charged me anything, which was terrific. And then I saw, after 2 or 3 years, I did get another Super 8 camera with sound this time, which is the first one I bought. And then a couple of years went by, and I saw a beautiful 16 millimeter Bolex camera for sale in a photo store, secondhand one, but it was gorgeous with a 400 foot magazine on it, an electric motor, and a zoom lens. And it was $2,500, and I couldn't afford that. I hadn't saved up enough money, so I convinced mum and dad to loan me the money to buy that. And that camera, I realized on 16 millimeter that everything is so expensive that it was going to cost me $100. By the time I'd bought a roll of 100 foot of negative, plus processed a negative, plus had a work print made of it, it was $100 for every 2.5 minutes. It was a lot of money for $75 a week. Wasn't going to go very far for 16 mil. So I started using the film, using the camera and saving up and buying a couple of rolls of film and then filming in the weekends. And I was filming a short movie because I thought at least it's 16 millimeter, I could enter it into festivals. Mm-hmm. And I could make a 20 minute short, a horror movie. Now I was doing something that was based on, I was looking at Dawn of the Dead, George Romero's Dawn mm-hmm. of the Dead, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre was a big influence at the mm-hmm. time as well. And so I was making a horror movie and a short movie, and I thought after a few weeks I might be able to get it into festivals, and this is the first time I can actually get something of mine seen. And I kept shooting and I kept shooting, and during the week, because I'd film on Sundays because it was my day off, and I'd have to work it on a Saturday to earn overtime to pay, because I was now working 6 days a week just to get the overtime to help buy the film. And I eventually ended up shooting for 3 years on Sundays, because I kept thinking of new ideas during the week. I'd be mm-hmm. bored out of my brain doing this photo engraving job, and by the time the next Sunday rolled around, I'd have all these other ideas of what to add to the movie, and the movie slowly expanded. And after 3 years, I'd cut the film together, and it was nearly a feature length, and this was supposed to be 20 minutes long. Mm-hmm. And I showed I showed what I had, it's about 80 minutes, to the head of the New Zealand Film Commission at the time, which is that had been set up because New Zealand had started to make feature films now. Mm-hmm. During this period that I was a photolithographer, after I left school, we'd made Smash Palace and Goodbye Pork Pie. Roger Donaldson, Jeff mm-hmm. Murphy had begun their careers, and things were starting to work and starting to actually happen in New Zealand.
Which was supported by the government at that point, or encouraged?
The government set up the New Zealand Film Commission, and there was a government, and they still do run the Film Commission, which is really the only source of funding in New Zealand. And they mm-hmm. had an annual budget which they would select projects to put money into. And I kept applying while I was making my horror movie, my 16 millimeter, you know, short film. I kept applying for some money. Like, I applied for $3,000 at one stage to help buy some film stock to mm-hmm. you know, and I kept getting turned down and turned down and turned down all the time. And then I eventually showed the guy who was the head of the Film Commission this 80 minutes of this film I'd shot, and it wasn't yet finished, and I still hadn't shot the climax, but mm-hmm. I'd shot most of it. And he was really great. His name was Jim Booth, and he said, look, I would have to submit this film to the board, because it's a government controlled board. They would mm-hmm. turn you down because it's a horror movie. It's got blood and guts and splattering mm-hmm. stuff in it. But he says he was allowed to okay $2,000 or $3,000 grants for script development without having to go to the board. So he said, so long as I didn't mind just doing it with these little dribs and drabs of money, he would fund me these bits of money to allow me to finish the shooting of the movie mm-hmm. under the table, as it were. And he was, you know, he was a bureaucrat. I mean, they never do this sort of thing. He was a really imaginary guy. Jim was great. And so it's exactly what happened, and I finished shooting the movie after another 6 or 8 months, and Jim was now giving me these little bits of money. And as soon as Jim gave me my first check, I quit my job at the newspaper. I resigned. So I was working full-time on the movie, just being funded by these little bits of grant that were coming in.
And is anybody, I mean, Jim obviously encouraging, but are there other people in your life who are encouraging you at all at this point?
No, nobody. Nobody saw the movie. No one saw anything.
And but you were just that focused yourself that you were.
Yeah. And I was using the actors in the movie were my fellow photo engravers at the newspaper. Everybody in the movie is a photo engraver at the Wellington Evening Post newspaper. And I ended up running out of actors, because I was obviously one of the actors in it, along with 3 or 4 of my mates. And then I needed another character, and I didn't. I'd run out of friends. So I cast myself in a second role. So I'm now in 2 roles. One of them's clean shaven with buck teeth, which I made, and glasses. And the other one is with a beard and long hair. I sort of changed my appearance, which meant every time I went from one character to the other, I had to grow a beard and get my hair long. I had to go. But anyway, it took months, so it didn't matter. And around about the time then that I had finished shooting the movie, I now needed to do post-production on the film, which was going to cost a couple of $100,000. I mean, now to actually do the music and the sound effects and get it all finished. And Jim said that I had to submit it to the board now, because now was the time where we had to come clean. But at least he'd got me, you know, got the film finished and helped me. And so he did. And he also introduced me to a couple of other filmmakers at the time. He said, you know, there's people you should really meet. Have you, don't you know anybody? No. I'd never set foot on a film set in my life. And there was a TV show that was shooting in Wellington, where I lived at the time, and it was called Wurzel Gummidge Down Under, and I got invited to visit that, and I was making little rubber creatures for my own film, and making rubber prosthetic creature, you know, heads for the aliens for bad taste. So Wurzel Gummidge guys got me to do some special effects for them, so I was actually now getting paid to do some special effects work, and I met a young writer on there who was sitting there doing rewrites on Wurzel Gummidge, who turned out to be Fran Walsh. Wow. And I said really nervously, you know, what you were doing, and I said, oh, I've got this film that I've just finished shooting it, and would you like to see it? So the first person that I ever showed bad taste to was Fran, in its rough form. And at the same time, Jim had a screening for the board, and they gave me money for post-production, and the whole thing got finished and taken to the Cannes Film Festival in 1987 or 8, I think it was, and it sold it. I mean, the Film Commission had put a couple of hundred grand into it now, and it sold for millions of dollars around the world, and you know, it was one of the most successful Kiwi films of all time, you know, given its budget, you know, in terms of
did you see
proportion.
Any of it at that point?
Well, I actually did. I did. It enabled me to stay as a full-time, you know, filmmaker. It meant I never had to get another job to pay the bills anymore. The Film Commission got paid out. I got paid. I shared all the money with everyone that had helped me make the film. All the other actors all got points in the movie. We sort of shared it amongst ourselves, a real kind of co-op thing. And we're still earning checks off it. The guy still gets checks back from it. And that then led on to, you know, Feebles and Braindead and on to other things.
So you've become kind of, at least in the perception of outside of New Zealand, the de facto New Zealand Film Commission on some level. I mean, you've really built the industry, or the industry has grown around you as well as your own.
Well, I don't. I mean, I, you know, there's a lot of other filmmakers that were working in New Zealand at the time. I mean, I'm a contemporary of Vincent Ward and Jane Campion. You know, there was a bunch of us who were in that generation, I guess, that particular generation, who were coming up. Jeff Murphy and Roger were the ones that were before us, and
kind of went off to Hollywood, I guess.
A few of them did, yeah. Yeah, Lee Tamahori was also around that time. He's sort of one of our contemporaries. So there was a group of us who were just the beginnings of this whole New Zealand trend. But I just stayed in New Zealand and was happy to do Meet the Feebles and Braindead, and I was working now with Fran as you know, as we became partners, and I ended up just doing exactly what I wanted to do as a kid. I'm the luckiest guy in the world. I mean, I'm doing what I wanted to do when I was 7 years old.
So is the magic of just a large infusion of cash through rings that has allowed it to become this next thing? I mean, obviously there have been some great filmmakers there, but now it feels like there's actually a business there. Now people are sending their work, you know.
That happened gradually. Rings kind of helped, but every time we made a movie, we used to try to leave some bit of infrastructure in place for the next film, because I was basing myself in Wellington. And I also was meeting, you know, important people in my life, like Richard Taylor, who runs Weta Workshop with us, and Jamie Selkirk, who is another partner at Weta. And we do things like, you know, we did Meet the Feebles, which was a second film, and we had to have a place to build puppets, so we rented a crappy old warehouse somewhere that was infested with rats, you know, and we were making these puppets, and we'd come in the morning and the rats had eaten into the puppet, and the guy had to, the puppeteer had to put the suit on, which was all full of rat droppings, and act the next day, and it was kind of grotty and horrible. So we made a decision that at the end of Meet the Feebles, Richard and I would find a warehouse, and we'd buy the warehouse. We'd use the money from that movie to actually buy ourselves an old warehouse, which would become our workshop. Mm-hmm. So when we did Braindead, we now had a permanent workshop. We didn't have to go find somewhere. And then as a result of Heavenly Creatures, we used the income that we got from that to buy another building, which became our first studio. Mm-hmm. And The Frighteners was shot in that studio. And then when Lord of the Rings was going to happen, we thought Lord of the Rings was possibly happening. A paint factory came up for sale in the local area, and it was a beautiful big bit of land with warehouses and some big factory buildings where they used to manufacture this paint. A lot of parking lot that would make a great back lot. And we made a decision to buy that in case Lord of the Rings happened, and it was very expensive, and we mortgaged all of our houses. We didn't have the money for it, and we got ourselves into deep into debt on the basis that the film was going to happen. And as it was, it almost didn't. And when Miramax were pulling out of Lord of the Rings and there was all this uncertainty, we were freaking out because we were going to lose our house on this mm-hmm. this land deal that we'd got to buy this factory. So after Lord of the Rings happened, Fran and I bought the post-production facility that was the National Film Unit, the place mm-hmm. that turned me down for my first job application. I ended up owning the company.
Wow.
And Fran and I bought that because it was about to close down and shift to Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And New Zealand was going to lose its only post-production facility. We'd all have to go to Australia to do our developing and to do our sound posts. So mm-hmm. we bought that business to keep it in New Zealand, and mm-hmm. that's grown into our what we call Park Road Post now, our sound post-production place. So we've tried it. It's not just Lord of the Rings. It's every step away we've tried to use each movie to build a piece of the puzzle, you know, the infrastructure.
Do you feel parental in terms of all this stuff, or do you just feel like you're kind of doing work with your friends and doing what you want to do?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's the same thing, really. I mean, doing work with our friends, you know, is important. But I do. I mean, one of the things that we do try to do is to help New Zealand filmmakers, like at our post production facility, where we have all these big, you know, mixing stages, very state of the art, is as good as anything anywhere in the world. We also make them available to the most low budget, cheapest New Zealand film. So mm-hmm. so anyone that was in my shoes, when I was trying to make a film for 700 grand or something back mm-hmm. in the old days, we will let them come and mix in our facility for peanuts, you know, mm-hmm. because it's there, as far as I'm concerned, it's there for New Zealand filmmakers to use. And if you're in New Zealand trying to make a film, you're welcome to come and use our facilities. So to me it is very important that everything we do tries to support the local industry. Yeah.
So as much as your legacy as the films, or the films really more your
well,
legacy?
The films are on one level the legacy for us personally, but these companies are there to, you know, I mean, interestingly enough, the last person to shoot on our stages was Jim Cameron, shot Avatar there, and you know, and our company Weta, which we set up. We bought our first computer to do Heavenly Creatures. To do 30 computer shots on Heavenly Creatures is now done, you know, 1,800 shots on Avatar. So it's weird the way it just keeps on going. But it's the people too, you know, we've just been lucky to have really good people working on our films.
Well, it seems like a place where people can go and actually think and not be distracted as much by all the stuff that's here.
Well, we're also very project-based, is what I think is important, especially for the computer effects side of the business, that you can be employed in Los Angeles or in San Francisco or even England, you know, within a CG facility, and you're going to be there, and films will just come in the door and rotate around, and you'll work on a multitude of different films. But in New Zealand, we tend to have people coming to join us for one project or another. So mm-hmm. so a lot of people came down to New Zealand. A lot of people, you know, brought their families down, their kids, because the Lord of the Rings is what we were making. And then mm-hmm. when that project finished, some people went back to where they came from, but a lot of people loved New Zealand so much and their kids were settled in school, they decided to stay there. And then we got another influx of people when we did King Kong, because there's a lot of Kong fans out there mm-hmm. around the world, and people just wanted to work on Kong. And then Jim Cameron, obviously, you know, Avatar, we were just, you know, we're doing Avatar, and we got a lot of people coming down for Avatar. So mm-hmm. We're very much a company who attracts people because of the particular project we're working on, not just as we don't do a million different jobs.
Right. So what was the draw to The Lovely Bones?
Well, The Lovely Bones, I guess, you know, I mean, the story in the book was... It was the complexity, and it was the fact that, well, what I personally liked about it was the fact that it didn't fit into a well described genre. You know, I think we live in a or we work in an industry today where everything is sort of neatly packaged, and you've got to simply label things, you know, A, B, or C. And I, you know, The Lovely Bones, I must admit, appealed to me because it had a complex mix of genres, tones, and subject matter. You know, on one level, you're dealing with the subconscious of this dead 14-year-old girl, and where her life force is in this weird sort of dreamlike state, which she calls the in-between. And so you're dealing with that. On the other hand, you've got the very real world of the parents who are grieving. You've got the twisted world of the killer who gets away with it, plans his next murder. So you've these different points of view and the ability to shoot them in very different styles, and then make all those different styles work as one piece was what attracted me. It was kind of the complexity of it, and it didn't remind me of any other movie, which is difficult. It's, you know, one of the hardest things I find today is to find originality in approach, you know, just to even think of ideas, right, that you don't immediately think, oh, well, hang on, that was already done before, or and I certainly don't want to repeat myself. I mean, that's the last thing I want to do.
But you had a lot of time in post with this child.
More time than we thought we were going to get, because, you know, Paramount had planned a March release, and I mean, I think we were going to be released a week after Watchmen. Mm-hmm. That seems like the Dark Ages. Watchmen seems like years ago, but anyway. And then they saw the movie, and last November we screened it to them for the first time, and they decided to delay it to December. So we used that time, and
so was finding the right tone and the right voice for it difficult, or were you gonna?
Yeah. I mean, it's difficult, and I don't know if we've even done it. I mean, I can't judge the movie. You know, other people have got to judge it. I, you know, you can only just ultimately go on your instincts, and I mean, I'm very happy with the film, but that tonal thing, I think it works for some people, and for other people it obviously doesn't work for them. So it is one of those films. It's a polarizing kind of film, I guess, to be completely honest.
Can you judge any of your work? Do you have that kind of perspective on older films now?
Well, I never watch my old films. Interestingly enough, I just about 4 months ago, I watched the Lord of the Rings movies for the first time since we made them, literally for the first time, because Guillermo del Toro came down to start work on The Hobbit, and symbolically, we thought we should all sit down and watch the three Lord of the Rings movies so that we have a tonal kind of continuation. Mm. And I mean, Fran we had to drag into the cinema. She just didn't want to see them at all. It's too soon, she was saying. But anyway, we got her in, and we watched the extended cuts, on 35mm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got prints of them, and I was less familiar with the extended cuts than I was with the theatrical versions. I hadn't spent quite as much time on them, I guess, and they hadn't ingrained them in my head, and it was weird because I was starting to watch them almost with a little bit of freshness. I couldn't quite remember what the next shot was going to be, you know, because you get to a point when you're making a movie where you just know everything and you know the rhythms of it.
Right.
But I'd forgotten some of it, and I remember being my real impression watching them was how complicated they were. I came away thinking, God, they look difficult to make.
You really had to be crazy to go do them.
Well, I can see that now, and I realized that more 4 months ago when I watched them with Guillermo than I ever had earlier. Actually, they came across, the size and the enormity of it, I guess, really did actually hit me at that point.
So, was doing a film that was based in America a challenge of a different kind, or was it
not particularly? I mean, it was. We did have a period where we thought we'd shoot The Lovely Bones in New Zealand, because there's areas of New Zealand that kind of stand in for America, and there's actually quite a lot of production takes place in New Zealand as America. Some TV films and things get made there quite a lot. But what we ended up doing was talking to Alice Sebold, the author, and she grew up in Pennsylvania, and she was thinking of she was thinking of certain areas of her childhood when she wrote the book. Not in an autobiographical sense, but just simply that she was, you know, the shopping mall and the school and things were places that she was describing that she was familiar with. And she drew us a little map, so because we thought we should go look at Pennsylvania and then go back to New Zealand and we'll find, you know, matching locations. But when we went there and had a look around, we realized that, it's very different. The architecture's different. And to also be true to Alice, we thought, you know, I mean, she's identified these places and we should really try to shoot them on these locations.
So what's the casting? I mean, Saoirse was kind of critical to making this movie work.
Yeah.
Was there really another option out there? Or did you cast around?
Well, we'd started casting. And we started casting in the States, you know, obviously, because we thought, you know, a 14-year-old American girl, that's where we'd find her. And it was interesting when we were auditioning here, we maybe had we'd started and we'd gone through maybe 15 or 20 auditions. And what was interesting is the fact that Susie Salmon was, you know, she's the film's set in 1973. And so many of the kids that were coming in, because we were auditioning 13, 14-year-olds, so many of them are utterly defined by pop culture today. And the way that they conduct themselves, they move, they talk, the speech patterns, everything about them is like Nickelodeon, Disney-fied. And I guess these are probably kids that we were meeting that have been actors for several years, you know, child actors coming up. And they had this whole this modern pop culture thing so ingrained in them that it was impossible to imagine them as being genuine 1973 kids. It was just an interesting observation. We were starting to get a little bit worried about it, you know, and thinking how you know, because they just they were a product of this modern culture, which I guess is not surprising on one level, but it was very obvious. And then Saoirse's tape arrived, and her father Paul had filmed her audition in their house in Ireland, because we weren't going to Ireland to do any auditioning, and so they sent us the tape, and we virtually cast her instantaneously, because on that tape was what you see on the film. Really, it was that wonderful performance, genuine and powerful, and she's just honest. Everything is real, and from a place of truth.
And you even have a chance to see the other movie or any parts of it, or
Atonement?
Atonement, yeah.
Atonement. She'd only just finished shooting Atonement, and we went to London. When her tape arrived, we flew to London, and they flew over from Ireland to meet with us, and we met Saoirse and her parents, because it was important to meet her parents as well, because she was 13 at the time, and you know, we wanted to talk to them about the film and the way we were going to show it, and we weren't going to film the murder. There were lots of things that Fran and I, as parents of teenagers, wanted to talk to her parents about, and looking after her. And we were in London, and Joe Wright had heard that we were meeting with her, and he was in the cutting room, and he very kindly sent over a DVD of a bunch of her scenes from Atonement, which was very nice of him. So we were able to look at some of her work in Atonement. But, you know, really, in all honesty, the casting tape that she did herself was enough for us.
So do you feel like you've now given birth to the baby, or has it taken this long, or did you feel like it was done when you were finished cutting the first time?
Oh, no, it's only just done. It's you know, there's no such thing as perfection.
Right.
I mean, it literally just doesn't exist. And especially in the film industry, there's no perfect script, there's no perfect edit, there's no perfect visual effect. I mean, nothing's perfect. Everything's a product of how long you spend on it. And so we've been working on the film. All of our movies, we work on them as long as we can until they take them away from us. And they've only just taken this one away. they ripped it out of our hands.
But in the meantime, you've been producing a ton of other stuff.
Yeah.
And not small stuff.
No.
Producing Steven Spielberg is not exactly small.
Well, Steven shows a lot of promise. I mean, Steven's got talent, and I predict a long and very interesting future for that young man.
Yeah, if you have Steven and Guillermo in your stable, that's not so bad.
Yeah.